It's a pleasure to be here again. I'm always full of admiration toward the capacity of the Korean people to get up so early in the morning. I know no other country where this is still rule. I suppose in France we have to start around 10:30. And a year ago, as you remember, Mr. Chairman, as you reminded, I was talking about the U.S. economy, and I would say that if I was to repeat the same conference, I wouldn't change much. I don't consider that the crisis in the banking system in the United States is certainly not superstition. It's a deep crisis within the banking system, but it has no impact on the U.S. economy as such. It does slow growth. There has been no recession so far, and it doesn't mean that there will be a recession. Therefore, what happened can be considered as an accident in the system. It is not an accident of the system. Many people would be disappointed because they would love to see the United States economy fail, and they would even more love to see capitalism disappear. But it is still not the case. On the contrary, it seems to me that in fact of the awful mismanagement of the American financial system, the U.S. economy and the global economy has proved to be quite resilient and able to absorb the shock of this mismanagement. In a paradoxical way, I would say that this financial mismanagement prove the resiliency of the American system and of the American economy so far. And that is something that the future months or years will modify my perspective. Of course, accidents and crises do occur, but as I explained a year ago, crises are in the system and no more crises off the system. This is one of the arguments on which I elaborate in my book, which you were kind enough to introduce. By the way, there's been some misunderstanding with my publisher. The publisher was supposed to distribute the book this morning, but apparently it was too early for him. And so I only have one or two copies with me. And the shifting from the United States to Europe and slow growth in Europe and what we can learn from that, what Korea can learn from that, everything of course is interconnected. Since the ending, since the late years of the 19th century, the United States economy is the leading economy. America is a leader in terms of growth, in terms of innovation, not only technical innovation, but also management innovation. And in any system, you have a leader during a certain period. Before that, the leader was the United Kingdom. And since one century, all the other countries are trying to catch up with the U.S. economy. Maybe someday, another economy will be able to catch up with the United States and maybe to take over, and the world will have a new leader. But so far, it is not the case. Because all the countries which are trying to catch up with the United States, be it Western Europe to start with, or Asia, or now India, or Brazil in Latin America, basically, they are emulating the macroeconomic policy of the United States, and microeconomic policy, management techniques, and the same kind of innovation. We don't see right now any kind of macro or micromanagement economic policy or any kind of product and technical innovation and management innovation which would be fundamentally different from what has been so far created in the United States. This is a fact. I don't say that we have to like it or to dislike it. It's not a problem. This is a fact of life, and there is no Chinese way, Indian way, or Korean way to build a car, or to build a cell phone, or to manage a company, or to manage a bank. You can do better than the US, you can do less good than the US, but basically we are all following the guidelines which have been defined in the United States. Now, if we focus on the Western Europe, which has been very remarkable in Western Europe after World War II, has been immediately after the war, gigantic efforts for reconstruction first, and then to catch up with the United States. And when we look at the Western Europe in the 60s and 70s, all European all European countries were catching up with the United States. In 1950, for example, the income per person in countries like France or Germany was half of what it was in the United States. In the late 70s, it was 80% of what it was in the United States. And the same catching up phenomenon appeared in Japan. So Japan and Western Europe were catching up with the United States. And then new countries did join the race, like South Korea, Taiwan, Singapore, and Hong Kong. So there was this conventional wisdom in the late 60s and 70s that maybe the economic model of the other countries, and not the United States, was better. It was better because it gave more importance to state regulation. It was, in a way, more directed to the state, some kind of planning, and the heavy public investment in certain sectors, in France, South Korea, or Japan, and also Western states, which certainly in the case of Western Europe, was more developed than in the United States. So at that time, the common wisdom was that the United States was losing the race, and that Europe and maybe Japan were creating a new model. This kind of a reflection completely disappeared in the early 80s. In the early 80s, a completely new phenomenon appeared. It has been the beginning of globalization. Why? For two basic reasons. First, the Soviet Union disappeared, or started to disappear, and it became evident that there was no more two economic systems, but only one, which was a free market open system, and that the other competitor had just vanished. The second reason is because of technical changes, and specifically because of internet, communication and exchanges became instantaneous, and we have for the first time a real global market in terms of information, communication, and capital. And it appears that in the early 80s, the United States were able to understand that the world was entering in a new period. Japan and Western Europe did not understand really what was going on. And many changes which had been implemented in the United States and a bit later on by Margaret Thatcher in UK took into consideration the new parameters of this new economic world. Specifically, the state had to be reduced, free trade had to be increased, and competition being everywhere, more liberty was to be given to the entrepreneurship And also the labor market had to be kept very flexible. Destructive creation, a concept which you know and on which I elaborated a year ago, destructive creation, the capacity to shift very rapidly from one sector to another sector because of foreign competition or domestic competition, destructive creation was the key for success. This was not understood or was not accepted in Western Europe except UK and Ireland. On the contrary, the Western countries, Western Europe, decided to keep the system they had before and that they saw as a better system, not only in economic terms but also in social terms. What has happened in the early 80s in Western Europe? Taxes have been raised, state regulations have been increased, the welfare state has been reinforced, labor flexibility has diminished. Why all these decisions have been made? They have been made because when growth goes down, you have less money. Therefore, in order to keep the welfare state running, and also with the population, which was getting older and older, you had to raise taxes in order to finance your welfare tax, your welfare state. So what happened in the early 80s was kind of a competition between keeping the welfare state the way it is, or the way it was, or limiting the welfare state, introducing competition in the insurance system or in the retirement system in order to give more liberty to entrepreneurship. Only the United Kingdom and Ireland took, let's say, the American way. All the other countries, they kept all things going the same and even increased with the rigidity of the economic system. And once again, it is not well understood, even in Western Europe, why taxes have been increased during that period. The very rapid increase during that period is, as I just said before, is a consequence of slow growth. If you have slow growth, you have to increase taxes in order to protect the welfare state. We can wonder why these decisions have been made in Western Europe and one, why they are still going on. The consequence of this, we are in the early 80s in continental Europe, mostly from Germany and Italy. We have a very slow growth, between 1% and 2%. Okay? And the demography is still increasing between 1% and 2%. The real growth rate is 0% since more than 20 years. Why do we go on like that? We go on like that because in this kind of stagnation, you have winners and losers. Therefore, you must understand the economic choice by political reasons. The majority of the people in Western Europe, they are rather old, they have a job, or they are retired, or they are civil servants. So for them, the system is quite good. There was no disruption in their life. In the case of France, to give you a figure, 25% of the people work for the public system, in the public services, state or public companies. Most of the retired people depend for their retirement on the state system. So the vested interest of the older people, of the civil servants, is the status quo. To change the system, a government would need to rely on the outsiders, younger people, immigrants, people without an education, young entrepreneurs, and these people who have a vested interest in changing the system are a minority. If we shift for one moment from Western Europe to Japan, the situation in Japan is very similar. If you look at what the Japanese economists call the lost decade, zero growth, 0% growth during more than 10 years, the lost decade in Japan, I think, is kind of a collective choice, even if it has never been promoted as such. But in fact, what did happen in Japan? Basically, older people became a majority, and many companies, with the help of banks, could go along without any consequence, even if they were losing money, so-called ghost companies. The ghost companies and their employees and the public sector, let's remember the postal service in Japan, the retired people, all together, they were the insiders, like in Europe. And they had a political vested interest in maintaining the system the way it was, even with 0% growth. 0% growth was more comfortable than changing the system and disrupting the system. And in Japan, like in Western Europe, and still today, I think it's even worse in Japan because of the demographics, when the political incentive to promote deep changes like tax cuts and privatization of the retirement pensions and so on, you don't have a majority to support this kind of system, which would make the Japanese economy, like the Western economy, more dynamic than it is. This is usually not explained to the people that way. You have quite a contradiction between economic reality and political reality. Nobody in Western Europe or in Japan is running for elections promising stagnation. They all promise growth, but they never include in the program the disruptive reforms which would bring back growth on its former track. When we talk about Western Europe or Europe in general, of course, we have to get into some distinctions. As I said before, England, UK and Ireland are on a different path and much closer for probably cultural reasons, and also because the situation was desperate in the late 70s, they have chosen a path which is much closer to the United States, and they have been extremely successful. Ireland, which was one of the poorest countries in Europe, is now among the richest countries in Europe, and London, as we know, is the financial capital city of the world. We also have to look at the eastern part of Europe. The eastern part of Europe, since 1991, wanted to get out of poverty and to get out of socialism. Therefore, countries like Poland, Hungary, the Czech Republic, Slovakia, proved ready to accept the free market method of the United States, and the results proved to be very good. If we remember what's been told about this country in the 90s, most of the economists, columnists, journalists would say they will need 50 years to catch up with the rest of Europe. This is not the case. They have proven that by rejecting state economic policy, central planning, by choosing clearly free entrepreneurship, by preventing, by the privatization of nearly everything, they are catching up very rapidly. And it's a huge success, which is altogether an ideological success and a success of free market policy. Now, I want to insist on one factor, which is not very often mentioned, and which explains the slow growth of Western Europe, and once again, basically Germany, Italy, and France. We have decided to work less. And the same decision was made by Japan in the early 80s. In the early 80s, you remember that the Japanese government decided that the Japanese were working too hard and that they should take long weekends. Public services and banks were closed on Saturday. Same kind of decision has been taken in Germany and France. For example, in the case of France, since 1983, it is legally forbidden to work more than 35 hours a week. Therefore, if you look at all the economic parameters, and I refer here to the work of Edward Prescott, got the Nobel Prize 2 years ago, Prescott showed that after all, what you produce in Korea, in Japan, in France, in Germany, in the United States is the same. We build cars, we build cell phones, we have the same kind of services, I mean, we are not really different. Management is the same, the technique is the same. When the technique is invented somewhere in the next week or the next year, it will be used everywhere. You visit the car factory in France, in Korea, or in Japan, basically it's the same. So where does the difference in growth rate come from? It comes from the quantity of work. So the parameter which explains the difference in the growth rate basically is the number of hours which are worked globally by a nation. This is difficult to understand and to convey. I was yesterday night explaining that to a journalist here in Seoul, and he told me that I work a lot. I said, well, of course you work a lot as an individual. But economists don't speak about individuals. We speak globally about the nation. And in South Korea, like in all the countries which have been mentioned, the quantity of work globally invested into the economy by the nation has been progressively reduced. It has been reduced, and as a consequence of the reduction, the growth rate went down. It's a pure arithmetic. It's very simple to prove, but it's very difficult to transmit in a political discourse. People are not ready to accept that very, very easily. So what can be done? What is to be done, I think, is to explain what is going on. Because in many countries where growth is slowing and where the catch-up process with the United States has stopped, to give you a figure, for example, in the case of Italy, Italy in the 1960s had a per capita income which was 50% of the United States, even 40%, okay? In the late 70s, it was 80%, tremendous success. Now, it is 65%, okay? So, it went down. It went down brutally. Why? Because it stopped working. Why did it stop working? Is it a choice? Yes. It is a collective choice. But it is not explicitly stayed like that. And one of the big mistakes, of course, is to think that by gain of productivity, you will compensate the loss of hours worked. This is not true, because you cannot gain more productivity than the guy next door. The productivity will be the same. Basically, if you compare the productivity in Korea, Japan, France, and the US, it's more or less the same. Same technique. So the difference, once again, is the quantity of work. So, if you want to get over it, if you want, in the case of Korea, to regain a higher growth rate, is it possible or not? There is one line of argument which says it is not possible because the Korean economy has reached a certain plateau, a certain kind of maturity, and in a mature economy, the growth rate becomes much slower than in the initial period. This is not completely true, because as long as you are behind the leader, there is room to catch up. So the rationale saying that we are mature, therefore we stop growing, this would work only if the production of Korea and the wealth, accumulated wealth of Korea, was the equivalent of the accumulated wealth of the American per habitant. This is not the case. You are still far behind. So the argument of the maturity is not a valid economic argument. It just doesn't play. The other argument, which is competition, is also not a valid argument. Competition is not replacing Korean goods or French goods with Chinese goods or whatever. It is increasing the size of the market. So what we have now is an increased size of the global market. Therefore, you don't have slow growth because of more competition. You have slow growth because you are not competing enough in a global market which size is increasing. So these kind of two arguments which you hear very often are economically non-relevant. Therefore, if you get rid of these two false arguments, you are back to what works and what should work in the case of Europe as in the case of Korea. I won't mention all the free market agenda. We all know by heart what free market means, what competition means. We all know what disruptive creation means, so I think it is not necessary to elaborate on that. The key factors, of course, is first the labor market flexibility. Labor market flexibility is an absolutely essential parameter. It's essential and it's extremely difficult to implement. Extremely difficult. Because there you are in a political fight against people who have no interest in labor market flexibility. And you are confronted with the insiders, not with the outsiders. The outsiders, the younger people looking for a job, they will never support you because they don't know that they are victim of the system. The insiders who already have a well-protected job, of course, will be extremely vocal. Therefore, to promote the free market policy, I would say the quality of the political discourse is absolutely essential. If a political leader is not able to explain why he's promoting a free market policy, he will not go very far. If we remember the case of Ronald Reagan, of Margaret Thatcher, or Helmut Kohl in their respective country, or Schröder, to quote the socialist in Germany, they all have been extremely good in showing that the free market policy and labor market flexibility would benefit the outsiders. They were always quoting the poor guy out there without a job and showing that it was the poor guy out there without a job who would be the first beneficiary of this free market policy. Therefore, explanation and the quality of explanation and the way to convey this kind of economic message in a very simple term is a key. If I may mention the case of France, so far the French president has not been able to convey this message, and this problem, this weakness in communication, is the reason why the reforms which have been promised in such form have not been implemented so far. I will mention two other factors which I think are extremely important in a high-growth economy. Education, of course. Everybody talks about education. Education has two virtues. The first one, the more educated the people are, the more able they are to accept labor flexibility. It is the uneducated people or people with a poor education who are unable to cope with the flexibility on the labor market. Therefore, basic education at the high school level, primary school, high school, technical school, and high school and college level, this is the key to implement flexibility. Second, to remain in the domain of education. It seems to me, but nobody, everybody will not agree with my analysis, it seems to me by visiting many universities in Korea, they are still very much behind what could be expected of a country like South Korea. It's a very conservative education. It's not very much open to the rest of the world. You have very few foreign students and very few foreign faculty. So I'm not quite sure that the South Korean universities right now are geared to high growth. This is compensated by the fact that many South Korean students go and study abroad, but they tend, in those cases, to remain abroad. Therefore, I think that one of the key, and I say that for Korea, but it's true as well for France, one of the key for high growth, as I said before, basic education for labor flexibility and higher education to promote innovation in a more competitive world. These things to me are some of the weaknesses of Korea. And also, and eventually, but I don't want to elaborate on this too much, because I spoke so many times about this subject in Korea, and I'm going to do it again in 1 hour at the invitation of the President of South Korea. I always considered, since many, many years, Korea is not using its civilization as an economic asset. The Korean civilization is not well known abroad, and the image of Korea is very weak. And I think this, as a consequence, brings some economic weakness. To tell things in a very simple way, and repeat what I've often repeated, if you buy a perfume, you will tend to buy a French perfume because it's French. If you buy a car, if you want a very costly car, you will tend to buy a German car, because this is the image of Germany. If you want to buy a very stylish electronic gear, you will buy something Japanese. By the way, most of the French consumers think that Samsung is a Japanese company, because it fits with the image of Korea. And the people at Samsung know that, and I had a discussion with a Samsung representative in France, and I said, but why don't you promote Samsung as a Korean company? He said, no, 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 we would lose consumers. It's much better. They think they buy Japanese, much better product. So there is the image of Korea is very weak, which means that you lack what I call a cultural added value. And I think that if you were able, by a very systematic public relations and advertisement policy, and I won't get into the detail of that, you would promote Korea as a brand. And the consumers of the global market will be attracted by Korean products because they are Korean. Today, I don't think, maybe in Asia, but certainly not in Europe, neither in the United States, I don't know of any consumers or many consumers buying a product because it is Korean. They don't. Because once again, the image of Korea is so weak. Therefore, among the many parameters on which Korea will work, the macroeconomic parameters which I mentioned, keep the free market going, have a lot of flexibility, encourage creative destruction, favor education to facilitate flexibility, and have better universities geared to the world so that you will have more innovation, and promote Korea as a brand in order to give an added value to Korean products. These are some of the elements, I think, which would help Korea to reconnect with high growth. And high growth can be reached because, once again, you are not at the top of the curve. You are still on the learning curve and for some years to go. Thank you.